Thank you, the organizers, for giving me the opportunity to present my work. Sorry to interrupt you, but. Anyway, so as the title says, this talk is going to be about whistle loops, again, supersymmetric whistle loops, and the aim of that would be to compute some of their expectation values exactly. But instead of doing this in n equal to superiors, we will do that in a DBGM model, which is a super conformal theory in the dimensions that I will introduce later in the talk. And in a sense, this is building up on the Bianchi question a couple of hours before. So he asked, can some of the things that were presented by Simone be also done in the ABJM model? And the answer is partially yes. As you will see, we are still behind schedule compared to the n equals 4 agenda for a number of reasons, some of which will be clear in a moment, hopefully. And so this work is based on a series of papers. The first one was still in the days where the archive had 4 digits, so some years ago. And this work has been developed in collaboration with several people, whom I want to introduce to you right now. So here is Luca Riwal from Parma University, Silvia Penalis from the University of Piano di Cocca, and Domenico Seminario from Florence. These are the senior collaborators. Here are the juniors, Andrea Mauri from Milano di Cocca as well, Michelangelo Preti from Paris, who is now moving to Stockholm, and finally Matthias Leoni from the University of Buenos Aires, who is the guy here on the right, performing a precision measurement of the speed of light with a microwave oven and a bar of chocolate in television. But yeah, apart from when he's on air, he's a very competent physicist. Anyway. So let me start with the conclusion. So the punchline of the talk is that we will be able to formulate a conjecture for the exact expectation value of certain supersymmetric whistle loops, which I call latitudes, and I will explain what this means to you in a second. This will be in a ABJM model, so some 3D superconformal theory, which I will present in more details afterwards. This provides a novel instance of a weak, strong interpolation, namely some object that you can compute from weak coupling all the way up to strong. And in particular, we will also be able to relate these supersymmetric objects to non-BPS observables, namely something related to cusps of whistle loops. This is basically the Mandelstam function that Simone introduced before, and thereby we will be able to compute them exactly as well. And so the motivations for this work, one of them is of course trying to ask David's question, so if it's possible to reproduce some of the things that are known in n=4 superiors to the ABJM model. The ABJM model is a good choice because it possesses a lot of structure. For instance, it has an ADS-CFT dual, its conjecture to be integrable, so there are a lot of ingredients with which you can play. In particular, the fact that it has an ADS-CFT dual and we will be able to compute some observable exactly means that we can perform a very solid test of the ADS-CFT, namely compare results derived in another way with some string or theoretic results if possible. And finally, let me say that it's extremely rewarding, especially for people like me who devote most of their time doing perturbative computation, to have some object that is known at all orders is really, really cool. Okay, so this is the outline. I will start with an introduction, which is mainly based in n=4 superiors. Most of this has been already covered by Simone, so I will be quite brief on this. Then I will move to a ABJM model, I will define it, I will introduce supersymmetric whistle loops in this setting, which are a bit different from n=4. I will define what the Mandelstam function is, so related to whistle loops with cusps, and tell you how you can compute them exactly. And finally, the novel part of this work is this metrics model for the computation, the exact computation of some particular whistle loops in a ABJM. And then I will conclude. So introduction. Again, Simone reviewed this as well, so I will be brief. So whistle loops are generic non-local operators that you can define in any gauge theories. They are defined as the holonomy of the gauge connection along the closed path. They are gauge invariant, and in some way they encode parallel transport in geometric description of gauge theories, much like
what you would do in GR. They have a lot of physical applications. Some of them were already mentioned. For instance, they were originally introduced in order to describe the quark antiquark potential, and thereby they offer some diagnostics from the phases of QCD or pitch theory in general. In doing this, basically, they also lay the foundations of the lattice approach to non-perturbative pitch theory. They have been sometimes used as a tool to describe heavy quarks, like in a non-relativistic effective theory. And I'm mentioning this because it will pop up again later in the talk. They also appear sometimes in when describing the infrared properties of scattering amplitudes. This is mainly connected to Kasper-Wilson loops. And finally, what will be very interesting for me, because we will be working in three dimensions, if you, for instance, consider Chersema's theory, then the theory is topological, so there's not much you can compute. Wilson loops are the basic observables. And interestingly enough, they are connected to the theory of knots in three dimensions. This was the very celebrated paper by Witten, which was awarded the fifth medal, as you can see. So this is another interesting setting for Wilson loops. Now we will go to n equals 4. So in this theory, you can define an object which is also super symmetric, at least locally, by adding a coupling to scalars, as Simone reviewed before. So you have some supercharges which are locally preserved. Thereby, the expectation value of these Wilson loops is finite, at least on the smooth contours. And again, these are sort of natural objects that you can consider n equals 4 because they, for instance, can be seen as arising naturally by Higgsing the theory. And in such a way, it was also clearer how to define the holographic dual of these objects, and in particular, how to compute them. And this was this very famous minimal area prescription by those people. And again, you can also define certain contours for which the coupling to the scalars can be chosen in such a way that you have some supercharge which is preserved globally instead of only locally. And one of them is the 1/2 Wippius line, so just a straight line. The other one is the maximal circle, like here staying on the sphere at the equator. But you can also have Wilson loops with lower supersymmetries. These are, for instance, the 1/8 Wippius Wilson loops that were introduced by Simone. But here we'll only be dealing with a particular case, which we will call latitude, which is basically a circle on the sphere, which is at a constant latitude. But let me point out that it's not just the contour; this also affects the coupling to the scalars. So it also describes some sort of latitude in the SPI sphere. These lines and circles can be mapped by a conformal transformation, but this is anomalous, and so their expectation value cannot be related straightforward. And finally, and most importantly for me, these are interesting because they are amenable of an exact computation by the technique of supersymmetrical localization. Here is a crash course on it. So basically, in theory, you take your theory, you put it on a compact manifold, and if the theory happens to have to be invariant under some Fermionic symmetry, so there is some conserved supercharge, you can try and reduce the infinite dimensional path integral that you have for your theory onto a matrix model, which is an object which is much, much easier to deal with because it's finite dimensional, for instance. And if you have some observables which share some conserved supercharge, you can compute them as a matrix model average and hopefully derive some exact results. This also usually simplifies if you take the planar approximation because you can use a several point approximation, but it's not necessarily required. And for instance, this allows to compute all the Wilson loops that I presented before exactly, and it goes for supermodels. So the line doesn't really need the localization, its expectation value is just one, it's trivial. However, the Wilson loop on the great circle, the 1/2 Wippius Wilson loop, can be computed exactly with localization. It's given by this Bessel function that was ubiquitous in Simone's talk. Or if you want to not to stick to the planar limit, there is this beautiful expression in terms of Legendre polynomials, which gives it two orders in one over and two collections. And finally, the latitude Wilson loop can be, its expectation value can be mapped to the one of the 1/2 Wippius Wilson loop by a simple rescaling of the coupling constant. This was something that Simone mentioned in more generality. It was basically it had to do with the areas enclosed by these 1/8 BPS width loops. This is basically the same. I mean, this shift is of course the area which is enclosed by this latitude width loop. Okay,
cool.
So even if these loops are supersymmetric, if you put them on a non-smooth contour, they will develop a divergence. For instance, the most famous one is a cusp. Then the width loop will be ultraviolet divergent. You have to renormalize it, and there will be an anomalous dimension associated to it, which is usually called the cusp anomalous dimension. In order not to make confusion, sometimes people call the cusp anomalous dimension also this object, which here I denote with infinity, which is basically the slope of an additional linear divergence that this cusp anomalous dimension develops if you take the light-like limit. So if you take the two edges of the cusp to be two light-like lines, there will be an additional divergence, which can be factored out, and the coefficient of it after some analytic configurations of the angles is also sometimes called the cusp anomalous dimension. Okay? And it is a very relevant object in physics. For instance, it controls the IR properties of scattering amplitudes of massless particles. It also enters as an anomalous dimension of twist operators if there are speed limit. And this in particular in an equal force superior means had a lot of success, because these operators comprise what is called the SL2 sector of the theory. People found an ADS CFT2, a description of this in terms of this spinning string in ADS, which is called the GKD string. Therefore, it was also computed to very high orders, both in perturbation theory and at weak coupling and strong coupling, using different techniques. And this also brings me to the next point, which I want to highlight of equal force superior means, which is already reviewed by David and other people, possibly, which is integral beam. So as you heard, the spectral problem of anomalous dimensions of an equal force superior means in the planar limit can be mapped to a spin chain, which happens to be integrable. And in particular, this offers all order results for anomalous dimensions of operators. Here's a cartoon, more or less, of the situation from the review by Weiser and collaborators, which was also mentioned. And you see that with integrability, basically you stay in this area where you take the planar limit, but you allow the coupling to be anything. So in principle, at least, you can compute observables to any order in the Toft coupling constant. It's not really a test in the proper sense of the CFT, because also integrability is conjectured. So, but it's like a mutual consistency check that everything is correct, and for many people this is more than enough. For the light-like cusp that I presented before, there is a very specific instance of integrability, which is this BES equation, namely an integral differential equation that you can try and solve numerically or analytically, and this gives you the cusp anomalous dimension in the light-like. One question would be if it's possible to extend this integrability picture also for space-like cusps. Okay? These are also objects which have a lot of relevance for other physical applications, for instance, in scattering amplitudes, both controlling the IR behavior or the energy limit. And they also enter in a measure of the quark antiquark potential of the theory. In order to get some mileage, I will first introduce an additional complication. So instead of just having a space-like cusp where the two edges are displaced by an angle, a geometric angle phi, I will also introduce like a separation in some internal space, which I indicated here with this arrow. And this can be parameterized by a certain angle. And this is interesting because you can find some BPS condition, namely whenever the angles are equal or opposite, where the cusp is supersymmetric. So you can find some supercharge which is preserved everywhere in this configuration. As a consequence, the cusp anomalous dimension vanishes in this case. And again, this setting has been at the attention of many people, and it has been computed to very high orders. One particular limit of this cusp anomalous dimension is when you consider the angle to be very small, and you take the first order coefficient of the Taylor expansion. This coefficient is what's called the Bernstein function, which appeared in Simonetto. Simonetto is a different slide context, but we will see soon that they are intimately connected. The Bernstein comes about because it, in a conformal field theory, can also be related to the energy emitted by a quark undergoing an infinitesimal deviation. So this is what, for instance, in classical electrodynamics, just proportional to the square of the electron charge. But here we want to retain all the quantum corrections. So, and one amazing fact of this object is that it can be computed exactly, first of all, and not only by localization, as Simone hinted at this morning, but also with integrability, which maybe he also mentioned, but with some less details. And so in particular, in the localization-based derivation, where there is some chain of reasoning that you can follow, and again, as Simone said, it can be related to the two-point functions along the line defect defined by the operators, but at some point it can also be related to the latitude Wilson loops, and that's why I introduced them. And the final answer for this, on this computation, is that the personal function can be given just by a simple derivative with respect to this Wilson loop that you happen to know exactly because of localization, so you have a beautiful formula for its exact expression. Moreover, there is also an integrability-based computation of it, which is basically derived by considering the spectral problem of operators inserted on this Wilson line. It can be mapped to a spin chain with some boundary reflection matrix, which is integral as well. And then you can set up all the machinery of integrability, TBA, quantum spectral curve, and derive beautiful results. One of them in particular is that you can find, of course, the same result as found before. And let me just point out that this is also a potential way of seeing whether there is some finite renormalization of the coupling constant. By this, I mean the following. It's not granted that the integrability process is basically using the same coupling constant as some other method. There could be, like an effective coupling. And it will see its appearance soon in ABJM. In Edwards 4, it happens not to be the case. And this is one way of seeing it. You compare two objects which you compute exactly to different manners, and you see the coupling constants. I mean, they can be matched without any modification, any rescaling of the coupling.
Just to make sure, so the localization doesn't depend on large n, or
No. Yeah, so here, just for simplicity, I wrote the planar result, but it's not.
So principal localization gives you much more than variability.
Yeah, absolutely.
And it might hint to how variability can be copied onto the grid.
I don't know. To the best of my knowledge, there haven't been many developments on that.
It's non-planar, but for a protected operator. Right?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. So it's not that. But then how does the group? Okay, I'll find out.
I mean, this of course, this agreement has been checked for.
It's not protected.
Well, the
fact it's a near BPS. It's a near BPS expansion. It's like the first correction to the Kasman analysis dimension near BPS limit. So it's not really protected, but it's close to it.
Because otherwise, you wouldn't need the grappling. I mean, the grappling wouldn't.
But yeah, I'm not aware of any attempts of deriving non-planar results for integrability. Not yet.
Well, I guess you can't with current techniques, but it might.
Yeah.
I thought that there is.
So if you can compute it by localization, it's kind of a supersymmetric observable, no?
Not quite. I mean, it's related to the circle, but in per se, it's not supersymmetric.
It's
like the normal dimension on the cusp. Which has a biggest condition at some point, but you are, as Simone was saying, you're perturbing away from that.
Yeah, I mean, it's this paper by Juan Sever and Correa.
By the way, this is a good moment for questions if you have any. any other? okay, otherwise I'll give the. So, the question, which is naturally, is whether we can perform the same story in other theories. And of course, if you want to raise the bar that high, that you want to reproduce everything, you need both localization and integrability. And this selects not so many theories that you know. One of them is the ABJM model in three dimensions. But let me mention before going to that there has been also some developments in equals to theory for pi by these people and others more recently. But I apologize for not referring to you in this slide. So let's go to three dimensions now. So if you don't know what the ABJM model is, here's a crash course slide on it. So it's a three-dimensional superconformal model with six supersymmetries. This is the superloop which is left invariant with the theory. It is a theory with a Chersonus action with two gauge groups and two opposite Chersonus levels, which are integer numbers, which somehow act as inverse couplings for the theory. It also possesses the fundamental matters, the matter fields, so scalar and fermions transforming in the light fundamental of the gauge groups and in the fundamental of some IC4 RC. So why is this theory interesting? Well, first of all, it was devised as the low energy model describing a stack of N2 brains, probably in this orbital singularity, and thereby it was possible to use it as a proxy for the ADS4 CFT3 correspondence. Namely, you have that this field theory describes well the regime where K, the Chersonian level, is much bigger than N, whereas in these two other regimes, there is a more appropriate type 2A description on ADS4 across CP3 or an iterative one for extreme values of these couplings. And there is, the tough coupling is defined as the ratio between the number of colors and the energy sum of the levels. Sometimes you can put also different ranks here. It's sometimes called the ABJ model, and we come to that later. But let me also point out that here in this intermediate regime, you don't know much, but the theory is conjectured to be integral, at least independently. Okay? So many things that are shared with respect to inverse force equivalence. One that it's not, as I said before, is that in all computations based on integrability, there is the appearance of an interpolating function, a function of the coupling, which is usually called h of lambda. It also appears in the scaling function, or the Kasparov's dimension, the Lively Kasparov's dimension, which can be gotten from the equals 4 by some rescaling of the coupling constant. And so this seems to hamper all the integrability-based computation because there is this function that you don't know. Fortunately, there is a conjecture for its exact value, which was put forward by Romo and Sisov some years ago. It's a bit complicated, as you can see, but in principle, no one prevents you from expanding these in various regimes and, for instance, get these results for weak lambda or for some. And it's a conjecture, but there have been many perturbative tests of it. For instance, this coefficient was checked both using scattering amplitudes and computing explicitly the bound dispersion relation in this sector. These people also managed to check this term again at strong coupling. The one loop term was already computed in the early days of the ABJM. There was some discussion about it, but now it's more or less settled. And with some collaborators, we also managed to compute explicitly the two-loop result, which is here encapsulated in this shift of the coupling constant here within this square root. And this also is a confirmation of something which was predicted as part of the dictionary of the ABJM ADS-CFT dictionary, which goes under the name of an anomalous zero shift. If you don't know what it is, it doesn't really matter, but it's basically a prediction for this shift appearing here. And so you see there are various different ingredients which show that they are mutually consistent. So this conjecture by Gromov and Sisov is very likely to be true, but still a proof would be desirable. And a way of doing that would be exactly to have some observable where you can compute with two different ways, one of them integrability, the other something else, and compare the results. And of course, an ideal candidate would be this Bernstein function if it were possible to compute it both with localization and integrability also in ABJM. All right? So in order to do that, I have to introduce the same ingredients that I needed before, and I will start with supersymmetric Wilson loops, the circular ones. So this is what it was like in N equals 4 superior mids. The same thing wouldn't work in three dimensions because the scalar has a wrong scaling dimension. So if you want to go to three dimensions, you should put two scalars. And the coupling is governed by some metrics. But doing that, you don't preserve one half of the supersymmetries any longer, just 1/6. Okay? This I will also refer to as a bosonic Wilson loop in the sense that here in the connection, only bosonic fields appears. On the contrary, if you want to, and since there are two gauge groups, you have two different objects that you can construct. If you want to have one half of the supercharges preserved, at least locally, you have to do somewhat more baroque construction. Well, actually, it's pretty baroque. So you have to take a super connection instead of a connection, meaning that it's a supermatrix with two positive blocks, which are more or less the same as here. But there are also two fermionic of diagonal blocks. And these people who proposed this this Wilson loop also derived a sort of cohomological equivalence between a certain combination of the 1/6 BPS Wilson loops and the half BPS Wilson loop. Namely, they saw that this difference is an exact term with respect to one of the supercharges which are which annihilate both of them. Okay. Cool. There was also a Higgsing mechanism that could be shown to generate this sort of Wilson loops. So there is here is the one happy Wilson loop in more details, but forget about the explicit formula. I just want to show that it can be computed explicitly. Again, as before, there are certain contours where you can retain supersymmetry globally. So not only locally, but everywhere. And these are again, for instance, a line and a circle. And as before, they might be amenable of an exact computation by localization. And this has been done, okay, by various groups. Actually, their proof goes for n equals to 2 super Chersemos theory. So they show that it can be localized on a free sphere. And here is the result for the matrix model, which emerges from these considerations in the ABJM model. This is the partition function. As you can see, it's much more complicated than the one for n equals 4, because it's not Gaussian. And this is one of the reasons why we are behind, because everything here is more complicated. It's a two matrix model. You can see it's two cuts. There are two different sets of eigenvalues and this pretty ugly hyperbolic function. But yeah, that's what it is. If you insert this operator, which is similar to the one in n equals 4, you can derive the expectation value for this BPS Wilson loop by expanding the phrases perturbed in the matrix model, and this is what you get. Okay? And if you want to have the 1/2, you add another piece here, and you see that basically these expectation values are related, and this is like the cohomological equivalence at the level of the expectation values. Unfortunately, there is a big caveat here, which has to do to these imaginary terms which appear in this expectation value. This is due to something which is called the framing of the Wilson loop. It's a pretty obscure concept which was originally pointed out in this paper by a Romanian mathematician. And the paper is in French, so it's not really user-friendly, but there was a translation in English and maths we can understand by Witten in 89. And what this means is basically maybe it's easier to draw a picture. So if you take your Wilson loop, you might want to perform some regularization of it if you complete the automation theory. Okay, so for instance, if you have your circular Wilson loop at one loop in perturbation theory, you will have a correction which is basically extending from one point to another. And one way of regularizing such a computation, if it's needed, is to the so-called point split chain regularization. So basically, you take another contour, which is like epsilon displaced from the original, and you allow one of the endpoints of the Wilson loop to actually end on the other circle. Okay. And by doing this, you obtain some result. But the magic of Chersemos theory is that the result of such a deformation depends on the linking number between these two circles. So for instance, you could consider some circle which goes like this, all right, which is linked once with the former, and this will generate some phase factor in the expectation value of the Wilson. Okay? This is what's referred to as framing. And for some reason, which is connected to supersymmetry, when you compute the expectation values exactly for Chersemos theory by localization, you pick up a particular framing number, which is 1 in this case, and then put it here. This index. And this is what generates these imaginary terms in these things. I'm sorry I have to introduce this concept, which is a bit strange, but later it will be relevant for what I will present, so I have to do it. But once you understand this thing, you can perform checks of these results, for instance, with usual perturbation theory, and they all work out. So we're happy with that. And finally, you can also add another ingredient, which unfortunately you cannot see here, but it's multiple winding. So you can imagine winding these loops n times around the circle, and this you can do easily at the level of the matrix model, or even in perturbation theory. And this also is an ingredient that will become important later, so I'll mention it here.
So when you say remove the frame, do you just mean ignore that imaginary part, or there's a procedure that you just not explain?
So in
understanding what is the framing?
At the level of perturbation theory, you can just perform the computation with whatever framing number you want, if you're able to do that, okay? And then compare it to the localization result that you have available for. This is, okay? Usually what people do is to choose framing zero, which was, for instance, what was done by these people. And in the simplest cases, since the framing is a phase, you can just take the module of the modulus of it and the chunk goes through.
Do you see this at Stronka?
So this is a very interesting question. I don't know. I mean, there are, as you will see, there are some proposals for these whistle loops and strong coupling. Of course, they can compute things and, for instance, get the exponential behavior. If you do it with localization, you see the emergence of some imaginary terms that you think are related to framing. But I'm not aware of any explicit computation where you see that from the string side. So like a string computation where you implement framing there, but it might be possible. So. But I have my so the final ingredient will be latitude whistle loops. So again, as before, you can define them. However, it's a bit unfortunate because the supersymmetry which are preserved are 1/12 for like a bosonic version of the same result as before, but displaced from the equator to latitude, and 1/6, which is a bit confusing because this was also supersymmetries which were preserved by the bosonic and the firm one. So, okay, now we have a maximally confusing set of results, but hopefully we will manage to go on. And again, these bosonic and fermionic whistle loops on the latitude have a cohomological equivalence, as before. Unlike n=4 supremes, they are not given by a simple rescaling of the coupling constant. They are more complicated. And in particular, by explicit computation, we found that it's likely that the cohomological equivalence is only valid at a particular value of the framing, which coincides with this parameter, which is basically the one which describes these latitudes. So before, the cohomological equivalence was at the level of localization, so at framing 1. In this case, we believe that it's this particular value of the framing nu, which is also a bit strange because here framing was like an integer number by nature because it's a linking number between two curves. Here, in general, it's a real number between 0 and 1. But that's what it is. As I mentioned before, the fermionic one has a strong coupling dual, which was found by these people. And yeah, an exact computation of them would be possible maybe by localization, but it hasn't been done yet. And precisely, the aim of the talk will be to find an exact expectation value for them. So yeah, the other part of the ingredients is the restore functions in ABJM. So in order to define them, I have to define cusps in ABJM. This can be done, again, as before, you have the choice of two different kind of connections, one which is bosonic, the other one which is the supermatrix. Here I will give you many details, but as before, one can generalize the cusp, so not just having two edges which are at an angle in space-time, but you can also introduce a sort of a displacement within the internal space of our symmetry, so the coupling with the matter fields. This with some sort of angular separation in CP3, if you like. And as n equal for supremes, there is a BPS condition for the one-half BPS Wilson loop. When the angles are equal and some amount of supercharges are preserved, whereas for the bosonic one, there is no such a thing. As a result, here you can take different limits for different angles of this cusp, and therefore have three different kinds of Mandelstam function. So this is associated with the fermionic cusp, and there is only one coefficient because by supersymmetry, as before there was a BPS condition, the coefficient of the expansion in theta must be equal to the one. Whereas for the bosonic case, you have in principle two unrelated objects which have the coefficients of the expansion in theta and in phi. So we have three objects which are amenable of computation, and our aim is to see if we can compute them exactly as before. And the spoiler here is that yes, we will be able to do that. And of course, the first who managed to do that were Juan and the collaborators. They considered in particular the small angle, the small geometric angle phi of the bosonic cusp. And after some quite roundabout line of reasoning, they claim that it's basically given in a similar fashion to the Nichols force theorem in this case, but it's different because you take the expectation value of a circular whistle loop, then we have the bosonic consist one, and winding n times around the circle, and you derive it with respect to the winding number, and then set it to 1. Okay? They have a lot of arguments for claiming this is the correct thing, but there are also some tests that we perform at your coupling, and in some places we were able to check this term. And the strong coupling also, by these people who were able to find both the reactor level and all the correlation. They also have a proposal for the cusp, the restaurant associated to the 1/2 BPS cusp, which is basically the same as before, but instead of taking the 1/6 BPS whistle, they take this component. There is something a bit strange of this. Okay, sorry. And you can use the homological equivalence to relate this to this object. So in the end, everything boils down to knowing how to compute these whistle loops exactly, which you know, because they were computed with a matrix model by Marino. So there's something strange about this object, namely it's an odd function of the Cher-Simons level, which means in particular that if you take it negative, you have a negative Restaurant function, which they claim was a bit strange because this should also give you the energy emitted by a moving fork. So yeah, it's a bit strange that it's negative, but anyway, that's what it is. So they concluded that the situation was a bit confusing and it required more thought. And more thought is exactly what we gave to it, and in this paper in 2014 we derived something which approaches the Bressel function from a slightly different angle. So what we did was to relate these two coefficients, so the 1/2 BPS Bressel function and the bosonic one, but associated to the internal angle. We related them to the latitude whistle loops, which I defined here. There's a type, this should be a B, because it's the bosonic, sorry about that. But the prescription looks very similar to the one by Mandelstam. So basically, you take this whistle loop, their modulus, their log, and you derive with respect to this parameter, which describes how far on the sphere this latitude is set. And then you set it up.
Maybe I'm missing how
The
winding number became the latitude. One is a discrete thing?
Yeah, no, exactly. That's
Okay, you want to explain it?
No, but I'm going to comment on that. No, yes, eventually we'll explain it somehow. So this is just, sorry, maybe I didn't put, so this is not derived following the arguments by Mandelstam. This is another way of deriving it, which is basically based on taking, as Simone was explaining, two point functions or local operators inserted on this line inference, okay? And by this way, these people were able later to prove that indeed this is the correct prescription. At the time, we were not very familiar with this reasoning, so we just more or less conjectured it, but then it was proved, okay? So this is a different angle from which you can tackle this result, but it's pretty successful. But now we have the problem of relating, as you said, the result of Mandelstam with this one, okay? In order to do that, we did some passages which are not really, some steps which are not really well motivated. So in particular, okay, first of all, we related everything using the cohomological equivalence, which is fine. But then we had to trade this latitude parameter with the winding number, which was not justified, as you pointed out. And then to ignore some terms which appear to be zero in perturbation theory, and also with numerics, but there was no proof of that either. But eventually, if you do this, you land on an expression which you cannot see entirely, but I can guarantee it's exactly the same that was proposed by Mandelstam. In particular, it only relies on the knowledge of this 1/6 BPS principles. So, just not to introduce confusion, these are not the latitudes. These are the circles these are the whistle loops on the great circle, which you already know with localization. So this means that you can compute this object exactly. Okay, so we start with something which is the latitude that you don't know, to orders, but doing these steps, which are not well justified, we were aiming at deriving something in terms of an object that you can compute. Okay. And also, of course, we perform checks, and other people did a test for coupling, and here is, since I did it, I just pointed out in a slide how the computation works. So you can directly compute this object in perturbation theory. We did it in a way which is using this heavy bulk effective theory, and that's why I introduced it before. The details are not important. We're just using some techniques which are common in when you do perturbative computations, also for phenomenological application. In the end, it boils down to computing a lot of Feynman diagrams, which is boring, but you can do. And the result is this, and it's beautifully in agreement with the conjecture that we did before. So we are very happy we have a three-loop check of it, which also extends to non-planar pieces. So again, since it's based on localization, also the non-planar part can be computed, even though I didn't show it before, and it works. So also the personal function computing is computed explicitly at the non-planar level matches with the prediction of localization. And since we are already computing things, we also perform the computation of the 1/6 Bernstorff function associated to the internal angle to four loops. It's again a bit of a mess, but you can find the result, and surprisingly enough, you find that it's just related by a simple factor of two with the one associated to the internal angle. So let me remind you, for the 1/2 BPS case, there is a BPS condition which forces these coefficients to be the same. Here, there's not such a thing, but still, we found an empirical relation between them. And actually, this extends also into the non-planar corrections of taking generic representations of the gauge group. It always works. And thanks to this competing group, they were able to prove this relation using, again, the properties of the underlying 1D effect, superconformal effect. So this is just to the recap of what we have done so far. We have these three coefficients, which can be computed on the one hand by relating their expression to the expectation value of latitude Wilson groups. With some passages which are not very, very well defined, we can relate this to objects that we do know how to compute, which are the 1/6 BPS Wilson loop, and in particular, what's relevant for them is the phase of these Wilson groups. Okay? Now, what we would like to do is to see if we can derive these results, these exact results, directly by computing this expectation values of the latitude Wilson loops exactly. And that's the final part of the talk, and that's the most recent one. So we don't know how to do it. So in principle, one could try to perform the steps of localization from the beginning, but we were not very sure how to perform it, because the supercharge which is preserved by them is not the usual one which was used by Capuste and the collaborator. So yeah, being agnostic, what we did was just to compute this Wilson loop, a three loop order in perturbation theory for generic framing, generic winding number, generic representation. We have a big expression, which here I show just in the fundamental. Of course, we checked it agreed with all the results which are already known from perturbation theory or from localization, and it works. And now we use this result as a source for conditions in order to fix an assets for the matrix model. And the idea is the following. I mean, it's very pedestrian. So you take the partition function of ABJM, okay? And you start thinking how to deform it in such a way to include like this parameter mu, which will account for the latitude. And one way of doing that, which is suggested by the relation to the Mandelstam functions, is this one, which is basically constrained by an inversion symmetry under this deformation parameter. This is like a sufficient condition that enables you to have the relations that I showed you before automatically valid for the Bernstorff function. It's not the only one, but it's the simplest. And so we start with this. And then we can plug a generic operator with some unknown coefficient, which should reproduce the Wilson loop. And by using the results that we know, one and two loops from the slide that I showed you before, and the fact that we think that the cohomological equivalence should hold the Fermi nu, basically we fix all the unknown parameters to be this particular value, root of nu, okay? And finally, we can check that the three loop prediction that we have for this matches what we had in this slide before, and it does. So it reproduces the the perturbative computation, of course, only at a very particular value of the framing, which is new, but for generic winding representations, which is, which I think is pretty cool. Another very interesting fact of this matrix model, which, it appears very complicated, and possibly it is, but it's not the first time that something like that appears in literature. So there was this matrix model looking at that, which was put forward by these people to compute torus knot invariants, if you know what they are. If you don't, take it for granted that they exist. So these are basically knots, as I described before. There is this paper by Witter where Chersanus can be connected to knots, and there are some developments of that. One of that, for instance, concerns torus knots. And these people show that if you want to compute these objects on a different Chersanus theory, so a Chersanus theory on this less space, you can ask me why they decided to do such a thing. It was basically to check, to do some checks on the Lupo-Kumar-Waffa duality, but apart from their original motivations, they already fixed this form. So this is something that already appeared. The only thing is that you have to choose Q and P properly with this square root of mu. Let me note that it's a bit odd because in principle these are integer numbers, co-prime integer numbers, but nevertheless we take some sort of analytic confirmations of them to a real case, which was also put forward in this paper by Tanaka, and it can arise if you pinch this torus of knot invariants to a circle in some degenerate case. One other way where you can see the emergence of a similar thing is if you localize any equals to superchain theories. And in particular, if you do that on a squashed lens sphere, this is the structure that emerges. After also some analytic continuation of one of the lens. So it's a bit complicated, but it's something that was already done in literature. This lensing, basically, it's what introduces this squash here, whereas the squashing here is responsible for these different terms appearing in the arguments of the cardinal branches. Okay? But this is also cool because there is literature, so people worked on this kind of matrix model, and this helped us a lot because, of course, now you can imagine what we want to do is to take the result that we have the strong coupling now and extrapolate it, the weak coupling and extrapolate it to strong coupling. Okay? This is what this matrix model are good for. But it turns out that if you try to do that directly on this matrix model, it's really, really complicated. I mean, there has been brilliant work by Marino collaborators to do that. And eventually they came up with a very interesting proposal, which is the following. So you can take basically the functions that were appearing in the matrix model, and there is an identity, which goes under the name of Cauchy identity, where you can rewrite them in a different fashion, just with this one of the Cauchy, with some sums, a sum over permutation, and some fermionic statistics. And by doing this, there is a bunch of interesting things that you can do. One of them is expanding a strong coupling, but before doing that, let me also point out that this formulation, which is how the matrix model looks like after the Cauchy formula, allows you to prove some nice identities. For instance, you can see that the bosonic latitude is independent of mu at even orders. And this can also be used to prove this identity, which was one of the steps which we used to connect latitudes to undeformed whistle loops, and then they told you that were not very well justified when we were computing Western functions. Here, using this matrix model, you can prove it. Okay? Something else, you can show that the partition function, so if you only compute this object without the insertion of the whistle loop, you can see that this object is independent of the deformation parameter if the rights are equal, or otherwise it only appears as a phase. Okay, so this is a term which also appears in the ABJ model. It's a bit unphysical and has been related somehow to this framing anomaly again. But why am I putting the accent on this? Well, the point is that eventually, so this matrix model I only conjecture, but eventually one would like to derive it from localization. And if you want to do that, the partition function of this matrix model should be just the partition function of ABJM, so it shouldn't depend on you. Okay? Whereas here, naively, it seems to do so. And so it's encouraging that you find that at least on this ABJM slice, the position function is independent of it. This means that it's very likely that it can come from a localization procedure where you use some supercharge, which might have a dependence on you, and so therefore you have some news going appearing in the partition function, but eventually the partition function should be independent of that, because it's just a ABJM on a sphere, shouldn't know anything about the latitude of the okay? And this is somehow encouraging. Good. So now finally, strong coupling. So, interesting observation, after rewriting the matrix model using the Cauchy identity, you see that the partition function is completely factorized. And there is this product of factorable terms, and you have these Fermi statistics in front. So this is the matrix model describing an ideal gas of random particles. Okay. And now, let's see if we can get any mileage with the starting from this other interpretation. Okay, so okay, this is some rewriting. Just to point out that the density matrix that appears here, it's not the standard one that we expect, because you see the kinetic kinetic term and the potential are a bit strange, a bit different from usual, with some hyperbolic function, that's what it is. And let me point out that the Chausenon level here appears, as you can see, as an effective h-bar, an effective Planck constant in this idea for a gas model. Cool. If we want to compute, so this is just a partition function. If you want to compute the Wilson loop, you can do some computation, and you see that there is an operator that you can insert here, and this will give you a statistical average which will produce the expectation of the loop. So now the idea, as I said, is to use statistical mechanics methods which apply to this for the gas to derive the strong coupling expansion of. Okay. So in particular, you see that the large n, so my number of particles, maps, of course, in this description to the thermodynamic limit, whereas small k was mapped to small h bar, and so this is basically considering the semi-classical expansion of this gas. And this is interesting because it's precisely the regime we need, so it's the regime where n is large at some fixed, possibly small k, which is like the strong coupling limit of the two descriptions of how where lambda tends to infinity and it probes deeply the unferritic regime. So it sounds easy, but it's not that straightforward. But fortunately, there is this paper where these authors performed all this computation for the 160 PS Wilson loop, so not the latitude, the antiform case. The idea more or less is the following, so you start by doing large n using a grand canonical formulation, which is better suited to deal with the thermodynamic limit, so introduce a chemical potential and compute the Wilson loop expectation value as a grand canonical average with Fermi statistics, as we see. So what you're after basically is this distribution operator here, where you can see inside that there is the Heaviside data, which is basically defining your Fermi surface for the gas, which on a PQ plane looks something like this, more or less. Okay? And there is a well-defined prescription that you can find in quantum mechanics books for dealing with this small h expansion, which is like the WKD expansion. And this goes under the name of Wigner-Kirkwood corrections, for those of you who might know it, otherwise it's not that important. The important thing is that all this is a well-defined thing that you can find in books and try to. Just as a technical point, we ignore here for the following exponentially small corrections, which can be there and have meaning. But doing that, we after a lot of computation, we end up with this result for the operator density, and from which you can extract very complicated results for the Wilson loops. Okay, I'm sorry if they're complicated, but that's what it is. Okay, so in particular for the bosonic latitude, you have this sum over two terms, which are ratios of very functions. If you follow the story in ABJM for the underformed Wilson loops, this is a very typical occurrence. So these very functions are all over the place when you expand the string coupling this sort of Wilson loops. As expected, the Fermionic one is a bit easier, just one ratio. And let me point out what the meaning of this formula is. So this is basically you're summing the genus expansion. So this is a formula which resums the 1 over n corrections that are basically the thermodynamic expansions in the Fermi gas formulation. And they are valid for generic K. Okay?
So do you have Stokes phenomena and all that business as well?
Yes, they're very conscious, so yes. Yeah, so if you take the asymptotics of the functions, of course, depends on the phase or where you take it. Yes. But for reasonably good choices of the argument, probably doesn't work. So these are formulas which are valid in the theoretical regimes, which is pretty nice. And up to a disclaimer, so we're not including here non-perturbative effects, which are those things that we discussed before, which are exponentially small corrections, which would go in either of these two ways, and these are like associated to what are called worksheet or membrane instances. So it's like non-perturbative effects that you can have in this setting because of, you know, brains like wrapping some cycles of CP3, which would be CP1, and then give rise to the worksheet. Instead of our RB3, which gives rise to the membrane.
So I asked the thing of the Stokes phenomenon exactly because of that.
Yes.
So if you have some kind of analytic continuation in K, then something like e to the minus k square root of lambda may not diverge, be small if lambda is equal, if k is equal to I, let's say.
Yeah, that's right. If you, in that case, yes, but I mean the physical values for K that we're interested in. Yeah, I mean, if you have in mind any maybe applications where you take complex Chersheimers or something, yes. But we were very down to earth. We just wanted to arrive at the strong coupling expansion and then do some match with the string theory description. That's what we are after. But in principle, if you take this as a function in the complex plane, then you have Stokes phenomenon. So it depends where you were. The asymptotics will depend on which direction you want to go to, yes.
So this is the area function with very large parameter?
Yes, so the expansion of that takes this form, so it becomes an exponential.
So is this in the part that it decays exponentially or in the part where it oscillates?
In the part of where it is exponential.
Okay.
So this is indeed the relevant thing in order to compare with the string theory description, and this for CP3. I'm missing out. Yeah, perfectly timed. Good. So you take the results before and you expand for genus zero, which is what is supposed to be described by the result from strings in this form. And for the Bosonic Wilson loop, we find this pretty ugly expression, which in particular has two different exponentials. Sorry for not mentioning that, but mu is between 0 and 1. So in principle, this exponential is always submitting with respect to this one. But the nu equals 1 limit is exactly where the Wilson loop is undeformed. So it's relevant to keep this, because otherwise you wouldn't be able to recover the original one. Okay. So this is an imprediction, because in particular, there is no string coupling dual known from this bosonic Wilson loop configuration. And it hints at the fact that it might be pretty complicated. So that there was a prescription which, for the uniform case, which is like a smearing of strings on CP1 instead of CP3, but possibly this doesn't apply in this case. It might be something different. However, for the Fermi case, we first of all compute this thing, and there is a prediction from strings there due to this. People. So in particular, at the time where we published our article, the exponential behavior was known and it matches perfectly with what we found. And after 1 month or two maybe that we published, these guys also had a computation of a particular limit of this coefficient in front, and this limit also checks out. So we're very happy we have an interpolation from weak to strong coupling, confirming the SFT. So let me conclude, because I think I'm out of time. So again, the conclusion, again and again, we computed this matrix model the conjecture the matrix model to compute the exact expression value of these relativities groups in BGM. It gives you a new instance of a weak strong interpolation. It's interestingly perhaps related to some other matrix model that appear in literature, namely this torsional invariance that I mentioned before. It's connected to the computation of non-BPS observable, namely this very strong function, and it allows to compute them exactly, although some exact results were also known before from other reasoning. We have extracted a quaternary coupling with an explicit three loop protoplanar computation and a through coupling, but this required this Fermi-Gas approach to perform the expansion. And somehow, yes, we have a new prediction for an object that hasn't been found yet, so it's some more work to be done. So indeed, what's to be done? Well, first of all, I would like to derive the matrix model properly from localization. And then one should understand this strong coupling well at the Gaussian latitude. And then there is something that I haven't covered at all. So do you remember that in Eigen's for supermins, one of the beautiful aspects of the Bernstein function was that you could compute it exactly both localization and integrability. Here, I only showed you how to compute it exactly in ABJM using localization. So the integrability part, which is indeed the most interesting because it would give you a handle on this echelon, is still missing. So it's not even known if the discussed configuration is integrable or not. I heard people saying it's not, but yeah, this is like an open field for research if you're there. And buon appetito.
Framing and appear in 3D and not in 4D. Is it a question of
co-dimension? No, I think it's related to Chersamis in the sense that, so you know that the Chersamis is topological, so it picks up some aspects which you wouldn't for dimensions. And for instance, if you want to convince yourself with a pretty concrete and simple example, you can perform that computation. So one loop, pure Chersamis, take this two circles, and you see that Chersamis is sensitive to the topological properties of these contours. And for dimensions, it wouldn't be like that. So for an infinitesimally small displacement, you would have just an infinitesimal connection. For so that you can describe.
But ABJM is not topological, though. I mean, so
yeah,
you might expect this to be broken.
But there is a subsector of it, which is so the whole. So from the point of view of perturbation theory, which is where I understand things the better, of course you have a Chersamis subsector of it, which is sensitive to this aspect, and then of course the matter part is not. So so if you take, for instance, propagators with scalar fields, that part isn't really sensitive to framing, so doesn't add anything up. The difference between the framing in a BGM and in pure Chersamis comes, for instance, because of these things, so so the simplest is something like this. So you have like the two loop correction to the Chersamis propagator, which is again of the same form of the three level one, so it's proportional to an epsilon tensor. And so again, you find a contribution to framing, which depends somehow on the corrections due to matter, but it's a Chersamis effect. It's not connected to matter. A strong coupling, it's hard. I don't know. I have no
understanding.
No,
from the string side.
No, not one whatsoever. I mean, I guess that in principle, if you want to expose that, you should perform like some sort of similar computation. So instead of taking the endpoints of your string on the same circle, you should have some slightly displaced circles in ADS. So like more a correlator of two Wilson loops, so to say. And this would be, and it also, if I just can just make one more comment, it reminded me a bit of it in this case, because you see that you have these two exponentials in this case. I didn't really know how to explain those, but I was thinking they might be connected to framing, because, this computation is performed by this matrix model, which implies that framing is new. So this is a computation at a certain framing. And so I was thinking that maybe these two different exponents arise because you would compute some string configuration with two different circles, like a correlator, and then some sort of cross-mediated transition occurs, and so you have two different competing exponents. But this is pure imagination. You don't have a handle on that.
Questions? In that case, let's find you a moment.